project, and the thesis that you're going to hear is our beloved director, Bob Love.
Thank you, Paul. It gives me such joy. Dream has become Sarasota's magical reality year in and year out, 48 years. Some of you are probably tiring from hearing us say that this crop of young artists has surpassed all that have come before. But you know, it is a source of perpetual astonishment and joy that this is absolutely true. For those like me who say that it is 2:52 for the future of the arts in this country and perhaps around the world, the most hopeful news is the extraordinary luminosity and fervor of these musicians who come from the finest schools of music all over the world and themselves hail from all over the world, and whose ability really makes all of us perspire a little bit and rush to the practice room and keep up. It's really something special, and you will see their ambassadorships of this cherished repertoire will require no additional praise from me. We have a program which is split down the middle, although not in that order, between two French works and the late 19th century master Johannes Brahms. Francis Poulenc was one of a group of composers known as les Six, the Six, under the spiritual direction of, on the one hand, Eric Satie, and Jean Cocteau was involved with them too. They wrote music which was distinctly French and most often light in character. Darius Milhaud, whose extraordinary Boeuf sous le Toit was performed a couple of days ago here by Joseph Lin and Jeannie Schneider, was one of those members. Georges Auric, Germain Taillefer, Louis Duret, these were all members of this group of six. And Poulenc's music is like every picture you will ever see of him, characterized by a roguish grin. He was known to say, "Ah, that delicious band music." His music is a bit of frou-frou, a bit of music hall, a bit of Rachmaninoff, a little bit of Prokofiev, quite a bit of Stravinsky. But above all, an ability in simple strokes to create music that can be absolutely heartbreaking in its lyrical directness. His songs are perhaps his most extraordinary legacy. I don't think too many people at the beginning of the 20th century could have imagined that Poulenc would turn out with his over 150 songs to be the greatest master of the art song in the 20th century. But that's how it turned out. And the Sextet for Piano and Winds is undoubtedly his most famous piece instrumentally, not just because Winds like to play it, but because it really is the quintessential Poulenc piece. You're going to be hearing the middle movement, the second movement first, followed by the first movement. The second movement with unabashed lyricism, but also showing that when it came to writing larger pieces, Poulenc had a short attention span. And so in the second movement, which is supposed to be a slow movement, he gets tired of it and then goes off into a romp in fast time before he finds himself back to the nostalgia of the beginning. Whereas the first movement, which you'll hear second, is uproarious, and then in the middle of it comes something slow and romantic until he gets tired of that and then it's off to the horse races again. So there is not a dull moment in Poulenc, and the brilliance and lyricism of the piece will blow you away. Paul Tavernel was a famous flutist and professor of flute at the Paris Conservatory. Virtually every flutist today still warms up using his basic warm-up. If you ever go past a practice room and hear a flutist warming up, you're going to hear something that goes like this. And so on. And that's Mr. Tavernel. When I took an ear training class at the Paris Conservatory, it was in the Tavernel room. And Tavernel, being a master wind player, wrote magnificently for the winds, and this is a very lighthearted piece which I think you'll enjoy, not lacking by any means in lyricism. Brahms, of course, is another matter. And the first piece you're going to hear is the opening movement of the Clarinet Quintet. As many of you may know, Brahms intended to retire as a composer after he finished the G major string quintet with two violas, Opus 111, the second of his two quintets, the first being the F major, Opus 88. And he was going to do that when he happened by chance to go to the southern Thuringian town of Meiningen, which had one of the most famous symphony orchestras in Europe. And the first clarinetist was a man named Richard Grünfeld. And Brahms was so astonished by Grünfeld's flexibility and virtuosity that he came out of retirement and composed four pieces, which are the glory of the clarinet literature, which are compared only with Mozart's Tegelstadt Trio, his quintet and concerto. He wrote first the clarinet trio, whose first movement we heard last night, and then he wrote the B minor quintet for clarinet and strings, the first movement of which you hear now, and then finally a set of clarinet sonatas, opus 120, in F minor and in E flat major. There's a wonderful letter, typical of Brahms' self-disparagement, in which he writes to the Duchess of Meiningen. He says, "I wish most importunately for you to invite me to Meiningen." He said, "I want you to know that I have seen you in your box, peering eagerly down at Mr. Grünfeld as he played his sweet song, and I have, for your sake, written something that you will, he will come into your private chamber and he will play for your personal entertainment, and you can use the rests that I have provided in there for the coziest conversation." Of course, I just say in passing that I've written a clarinet quintet, and that's sort of the incidental part. And the clarinet quintet of Brahms is one of his most serious and most haunting pieces. It begins speculatively in a world which doesn't seem to be able to center on whether it's lyrical or it's melancholic. And it takes a while for the depth of the sorrow to sink into our consciousness. And the piece is really one of the greatest of Brahms's and thereby of anybody's masterpieces. The entire piece is suffused with this kind of balance between a nostalgia towards something past and a sense of irretrievable sorrow. And it lasts until at the very end of the quintet, in the fourth movement, the opening that you will hear here is returned to and really causes the whole cycle to finish. Now, as I said, Brahms tended to be very self-deprecating and almost silly in the way he put down his own pieces. However, when he finished the C major piano trio, Opus 87, he wrote to his publisher, Fritz Zimrock, and said, "You will not have received a piano trio this good in 20 years." Now, when somebody like Brahms says something like that, you can be prepared for something extraordinary. And the C major trio, which is about half the length of the B major, is a piece of heroic aspirations and of Brahms in the grandest and most effusive of his many artistic states. So, it's a short program, four masterpieces. Enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.